Welcome to another encouraging message from Hope Community Church. We're so glad that you've taken a moment to tune in and pray that you find the message helpful as you discover your life's purpose in Christ. At the end of the message, we'll give you some additional ways you can interact with Hope.
Believe those authorities consider a blasphemous lie, and I knew they'd kill me too. Paranormal. Jesus just stood there. I saw him raise Lazarus with my own eyes. I saw him do it. And yet, he let himself be crucified. Why? None of it made any sense.
Alive. Alive?
here, and everyone saw him but me? I can't believe it. I can't believe they saw him. I'm being honest, I can't believe I missed it.
I was with John when the women came back from the tomb.
Alive? What?
I ran back to the tomb, but he wasn't there. I wanted to understand.
I mean, there were the grave clothes, but
he wasn't there. This could not be denied.
So I challenged them. I said, unless I see the nail marks in his hands and his feet, and I put my hand in his side, I won't believe it.
In one last desperate breath, I asked the man who I thought was the gardener, sir, if you have carried him away, please tell me where you have taken him and I will go get him. He turned to me and said,
Thomas.
Mary. He said my name, and I knew it was him, my Lord.
In that instant, everything changed.
I saw the wounds in his hands and his feet. I saw him, and he saw me. All the doubting ended. I believe.
He really is alive! Peter, he's alive!
He's alive! Yes, I know he's alive! I know! Trust me, I know how to doubt. But it's why we're telling you today so that you don't have to. In fact, he said, blessed are those who believe and have not yet seen. That's you.
I know he's alive for those who are suffering with regrets.
Or who are uncertain of the future.
Well, I know that dawn has come and Christ is risen. Amen. He is risen!
Amen. He is risen indeed!
Yeah. flashing light at the bypass, you know what I mean? That's how off Dayton was. But anyway, Lynn and I were attending college there, Christian college. Got I want you to get the idea that, you know, we went to chapel three times a week, unless I skipped chapel so that we could make out behind the chapel. No, we didn't do that. We had Christian professors. I mean, we had great Christian friends, and we were preparing. We felt like there would be some kind of a ministry for us. Thought it might be in the counseling area. It didn't. Well, I sort of do some counseling, but anyway, in the middle of that, in that preparation for ministry in a Christian environment, on a Christian college campus, I was drafted on the very last draft Vietnam War. My number was 87. It was like, woohoo, I finally won something. But I went from that Christian campus atmosphere to Navy boot camp. Okay? You get the picture? Like, I heard words I didn't even know what they meant. But, yes, he did. Can you kind of imagine that shift? Maybe some of you have been in a shift like that, that cultural shift, to go from a place where everybody cares about you spiritually, where you know, professors, they pray with you, they care about you, into this other culture called the Navy and Navy boot camp. Well, when I got there, I searched for some Christian friends. Could not find any. I could not find any. And then I went to the chapel service, and I was like, please, that was a bunch of gobbledygook. I don't know what it had to do with it, but it didn't have to do with Jesus. And I remember going back to our barracks, and I had never felt so alone, so cut off from all my Christian brothers and sisters. And really, I felt cut off from God. Have you ever felt that way? Have you felt like, I mean, I was just like, I was in a strange place where I didn't know anybody. But I was missing that Christian companionship, that Christian fellowship. And I couldn't even sense Jesus. Honestly, I couldn't. And I kind of think that's exactly how the disciples must have felt on that Friday night. We talked about it last week. If you missed it, you can go online and listen to it. We talked about Mary and Peter and Thomas. And how Jesus had come into Mary's life and had cast out seven demons. And woo, she was experiencing a new freedom in Jesus. But all of a sudden, Jesus was dead. Jesus was buried in a tomb. She saw it with her own eyes. Peter, he is the phenomenal failure of all time. I mean, hey, by the way, next time you're critical of Peter, how would you like all of your fears, failures, and flaws to be published in a bestseller worldwide? Would you like that? No. Somebody write down everything you've done wrong and then put it in a bestseller that goes around the world. Think about Peter, the last interaction before Jesus goes into that tomb. The last interaction is three times he denied Jesus. Denied knowing him. Using his finest fisherman's language to deny Jesus. Thomas, the doubting didn't start after Jesus was risen. Really, his doubting was way before that. And even in the upper room, when Jesus tells him, I'm going to prepare a place for you, Thomas is kind of like, yeah, sure. Look, we don't know where you're going. We don't know how to get there. You're talking in circles. You're talking in some foreign language. I doubt you know what you're talking about, Jesus. You see, for all of them, by the time Friday night came, all hope had died. It was a little bit like me laying in that bunk with that naval facility, feeling so alone, so caught off, and even saying, Jesus, where are you? Have you ever been there? Have you ever had one of those dark nights where it just seems like, yeah, I experienced all this stuff with Jesus, but now I'm just in a dark place. For me, I can identify with those people, Mary, Peter, Thomas, maybe you can too. But then Easter morning came and it changed everything. In fact, three little words changed everything. Three little words changed the world forever. Whether people choose to believe in Jesus Christ or not, three words absolutely changed human history. And those three words are, He is risen. Can you read it with me? Let's say it together.
He is risen.
It changed everything. It changed everything. The hopelessness that Mary and Peter and Thomas felt, suddenly their world was turned upside down. Again, because the hopelessness, the despair, the dark night that they were in, it all changed in a moment because Mary received the words first, He is risen. He is risen. And I love this. Jesus makes sure that his followers understand what it means, these powerful words. He is risen. Look at what he says to his followers right before he ascends to the Father. This is what he says recorded for us in Matthew chapter 28. Jesus came up to them and said to them, all authority, all power of absolute rule in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Jesus wanted them to understand, I am not the Jesus you encountered before the cross. I am not the Jesus you saw die on the cross. I am not the Jesus you saw buried in a tomb. I am the resurrected Jesus, and all authority and power has been given to me. I have a little understanding what this means, what it looks like. When I was in the Navy and we were out at sea, the commander of the ship has got all authority. It's kind of scary. If you've ever been in the military, especially been out on a ship, you know exactly what I'm talking about. It's kind of scary. They have all the authority. All. And Jesus makes this statement. I'm not the same Jesus that first came into your life. I am the risen Jesus, and all authority has been given to me. I think about Mary, how Jesus encountered Mary, this one that had been held captive. The Bible tells us by seven demons. She had been held captive, seven being the number for perfection. In other words, like in every way that she could be dominated by Satan, she was dominated by Satan. She was tormented. And Jesus had come and delivered her. But again, when she got to that Friday night, she said, what's going to happen to my deliverance? Are all those demons going to come back? Jesus has some powerful words for Mary on that first Easter morning. Mary being the one that approaches the tomb and is the first to get the message that He is risen. And I think it's very interesting. Jesus takes her from being a captive to being a commissioned witness. Jesus says to her, this is what he says to her. He says, I want you to go and tell my disciples. Go and tell my followers. But I've never noticed it before, exactly what Jesus' message was. Mary was so excited. By the time she got to the disciples, she just said it point blank. As the commissioned witness, she says, He is risen. I have seen the Lord. Those are her words. I have seen the Lord. I can see Peter and John and all them saying, oh, Mary, you're hallucinating, Dad. You're back on. Oh, man. You know, one of those things. No, I have seen the Lord. Jesus commissioned her to be the first witness. By the way, for those that have a problem with women in ministry, I got news for you. You got to deal with Jesus because he commissioned Mary to be the first one to tell the good news. Just think about that for a minute, folks. He commissioned Mary. He said, I want you to go. And then I noticed exactly what he wanted Mary to say. He said, this is what he, because Mary, so excited. Wouldn't you be excited? The Jesus you thought was dead, and then all your hopes and dreams and you're thinking, oh no, all those things that held me captive and Jesus delivered me, I might go back to that life of sin again. And all of a sudden she sees Jesus in his resurrected form. She knows that all the power has been given to him. She doesn't have to worry about that past anymore. She has been set free, and she just wants to hold on to him. Woo! She wants to cling to him. She's getting excited. And Jesus is like, whoa, hold up, girl. This way says, I have not yet ascended to my Father. And then these words that I think most of us, if you've read the story, have skipped over. If you haven't heard the story, listen to them fresh and new. He says, go find my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, my God and your God. Jesus commissions Mary with one of the most powerful messages that could ever be preached. Jesus says, when you put your faith and trust in me, you have a new Father. My Father is your Father. You have a new God. My God is your God. Think about that. Jesus is telling Mary, all those things that held you captive, you can look at Satan now and say, ha, you are done. You're done controlling me. You're done manipulating me. You're done trying to drag me back to a former life, because guess what? I have a new Heavenly Father. I have a new God, and he has overcome everything that you might throw at me. That's the message that Mary got to take to the brothers and sisters in Christ that were mourning the death of Jesus. Woo! That's good news. We say it's good news. That is good news. And that's Mary's message to you and I today. He has set us free to be his divine messengers. He has set us free just like Mary. Don't you know she had a powerful witness after that? And Jesus commissioned her to be the first to tell the story that changed the world. Well, then there's Thomas. I love old Thomas. We were really honest about it. There's more of us that are doubters than believers. Thomas is just, you know, the one they wrote about in the book, right? But Thomas says, you know what? When they come back and they say, oh, he's risen. He says, I'm not believing it. Until I see the wounds and I can touch them with my own hands, I want to be able to touch the wound in his side where the spear went in and confirm his death. Unless I can touch him, that's what Thomas says, unless I can touch him, I'm not believing. Have you met people? Maybe you're one of those people. Conditional faith. Oh, I'll believe Jesus as long as he does what I want him to do, when I want him to do it, how I want him to do it. There's plenty of people running around like that. I'll believe Jesus if. Well, as I looked at the story of Thomas, this is how incredibly loving Jesus is. He is so loving to Thomas that when he confronts Thomas 8 days after the resurrection, he already knows the doubts that Thomas has. John reports for us that when Jesus appears, he said directly to Thomas, Thomas, go ahead. Come on, Thomas. Put your fingers right here. They had no conversation, no interaction. Jesus says, come on, put your fingers right here. Come on, Thomas. Knowing that Thomas was demanding not just to see it, but he wanted to feel it. He wanted to know this is real, not some ghost, not some imagination, not some emoji or drop the phone or something like that. This is real. All it took was Jesus' presence. And Thomas fell to his feet, my Lord. He didn't need any more proof. The risen Jesus had appeared to him. What I think is interesting is Jesus says, you know what? Give me your doubts. Give me your doubts about me and who I am. I will meet you right where your doubts are. If you want a really good book about that, please Google A Case for Christ. A Case for Christ, Lee Strobel, a confirmed atheist, wrote that book. So I'm going to tell you about it, but you got any doubts about Jesus? Get that book. How many of you know Hagar the Horrible, the cartoon? Hagar the Horrible? You ever heard of it?
Yeah.
How many of you heard of Hagar the Horrible? You know what I'm talking about? The rest of you? Oh, come on. You've got to get into the Enlightened Age, please. He's a great theologian. So Hagar the Horrible is praying. And this is what he says. It's not easy to believe in you, God. We never see you. How come you never show yourself? How do we even know you exist? And then in the next frame, you see a flower springing up to life beside Hagar. And then a volcano erupting in the distance, the eclipse of a sun turning the sky black, a star shooting across the stratosphere, a tidal wave rushes over Hagar, lightning is flashing, a bush begins to burn, and a stone rolling away from the entrance to a tomb. Hagar pulls himself from the mud, dripping wet, surrounded by the darkness. He says, okay, I just give up. Every time we get into this discussion, we get interrupted. There's a more around you about God than you know. But you know what? God is not afraid of your doubts. Jesus is not afraid of your doubts. He will meet you just like he did Thomas, right at that point where you have your doubts. And if we're like Hagar the Horrible, if we're paying attention, he will answer every one of those doubts. He will. And then I think about good old Peter. Flawed, failed. It's interesting, after Jesus was crucified, after he showed himself to the disciples, so Peter knew he was alive again, Peter was so ashamed of his failures. So ashamed of the things he had said and done against Jesus, rejecting him, turning his back on him, that he went back to his comfort zone. You got a comfort zone? Mine is food. See, I'm married to a wife that she understands food is really there to fuel your body. I think food is there to make you feel good, okay? You know, like, nothing is better than warm chocolate chip cookies out of the oven with a glass of milk or something like that. The Butterfinger cookies. If you've never had Miss Penny's Butterfinger cookies, drive her after the service. And really, if you're really nice, you just buy a whole bunch of the candy bars and just take them and put them on her desk and say, could you please make... Yeah. Peter slipped back to his comfort zone, which is fishing. How many of you got fishing as a comfort zone? Huh? Come on, be honest. Yep. Fishing is your comfort zone. I see your hand go up, James. That's what he did. Peter went back to his comfort zone. He was too ashamed to face Christ. Have you ever been too ashamed to face Jesus because you failed him, you let him down? And you feel like he's never going to use me again. I've just messed up too bad. And so I'm just going to slip back in my little comfort zone and nurse my wounds. That's what Peter did. He's going to go back to his comfort zone and just nurse his wounds. I think it's fascinating that Jesus meets him right at his comfort zone. Jesus isn't going to let Peter go. Jesus meets him right there where he's fishing. In fact, helps him catch a fish. And then you know what he does to the comfort zone? He fries it up for breakfast. Be careful, that's what Jesus might do with your comfort zone. That's what he did. He took those fish and he had a nice fish breakfast waiting for Peter and the others when they came ashore. And to Peter, Jesus has some specific words. Peter, feeling like he could never even look Jesus in the face. Have you felt like that? Felt like your failures were so bad that you couldn't even look Jesus in the face? And Jesus, just like a teacher talking to a toddler, I believe, is like, hey, Peter, I don't know. Come on, make sure you're looking at me. And Jesus restores him, in fact, gives him an incredible new purpose for living. He says, Peter, I want you to tend my lambs. I want you to feed the new little baby Christians that are going to come along. What Peter didn't know was just in a few days he's going to preach and 3,000 new baby Christians are going to be born. And Jesus says, Peter, yes, with all your faults, with your fears, your failures, I am looking to you to feed them. Guess what? You might have a lot of fears and failures. Maybe Jesus is looking to you to feed younger Christians, to teach them. Not only that, Jesus says, and that I want you to tend to the sheep, those that are mature in their faith. I want you to challenge them and encourage them and grow them up in their faith. And then finally, Jesus says, then I want you to tend the flock. I want you to make sure that you're taking care of the church. That's what Jesus did for just one man who was full of failure and flaw. Jesus took him from flawed to a fabulous follower. Somebody might say, wait, you're going to say leader? No. Because you know what? Jesus knows our weaknesses. And Peter could easily say, hey, look at me, I'm Peter, I'm the big guy. In this commission, Jesus says, Peter, follow me. Follow me. I just want you to be a faithful follower. Yeah. Jesus can take your fears, your failures, and by just putting your faith and trust in the risen Jesus, you too can become a faithful follower. I like the way Paul puts it here. He kind of sums up the whole resurrection story. My old self has been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ lives in me. So I live in this earthly body by trusting in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. There it is. He gave himself for me. He died on the cross for me. But I put my life into his hands because he lives now. He's alive. So I don't know where you are in your journey. I don't know if you're like Thomas. Maybe you still have doubts about who Jesus is. I promise you, just like Thomas, Jesus will meet you right where your doubts are. Or maybe you're like Peter, and the fears and the failures and the flaws of life, you feel like you just can't be of any use to Jesus anymore. Peter becomes one of the leaders of the early church. And as untrained as he is, in his first two sermons, 8,000 give their lives to Jesus. I wouldn't call that a failure, would you? And Mary went from being somebody that was held captive to being a commissioned witness for Jesus, given the privilege of being the first person to bear the good news to the world. He is risen. On your seat when you came in, you should have found a card, and I'd like everybody to put that card in. And they look like this. They look like this. Pastor Skid, do we have more if we need them? If you need a card, I just encourage everybody to get a card out. But see, here's the thing. Hearing the message of Jesus Christ this morning, it absolutely demands a response. Your response can be nothing. Your response could be, today I'm choosing to follow Jesus. But today I'm claiming deliverance for something that has held me captive. Today I'm committing to tell others what Jesus has done for me. Maybe you still have doubts. There's nothing wrong with that. Like I said, Jesus will meet you right where your doubts are. I started out telling you how I was in that barracks, feeling so alone, feeling like I couldn't even feel Jesus in a very foreign culture, trying to keep my faith alive. And in those moments, Jesus came to me and he whispered in my ear, he said, you're going to know what it's like to depend on just me. And over the course of the next 9 weeks, it was just Jesus and me. I had no other Christian fellowship. I had my Bible, I had Jesus, that was it. But you know what? In spite of all my failures, all my doubts, all the things that held me captive, I went on to Airman School, and Jesus not only gave me Christian friends, but gave me the opportunity to lead other guys to Christ, to lead a Bible study. All those things Jesus was preparing for me. And most important, I didn't let go in those dark moments. But I still trusted Jesus. What's your response going to be to Jesus this morning? I believe he's asking for a response. The risen Jesus is. The one that says all the things have been given to me. The power to help you overcome. The power to help you believe. The power to be the follower of Christ calls you to be. So the band is going to play and sing. And what I challenge you to do this morning is respond not to me. This isn't about responding to me. This is about responding to Jesus. And what is he asking you to do this morning? What is he asking you to do? I challenge you to put it on this card. If you want to put your name on, you can. And as the Lord leads you, if you would come and just place it on the altar here, give it to Jesus. Whatever that is, don't be afraid. Jesus can handle your doubts, your fears, your failures. He's overcome all those. Don't be held captive by something that's held on to you so long. Discover what Mary has discovered. You can be set free and really gone free. Jesus, as we just wait in your resurrected presence, pray that you would move on our hearts, that we would answer whatever it is you're calling us to this morning. And I know it might sound a little quirky or whatever, that we got to stand up, walk down front. But Jesus, there's something about standing up for you. There's something very liberating about, you know what, I don't really care about the opinions of others. I care about the opinion of the risen Jesus. May we respond to you this morning as we wait in your risen presence.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for listening. If you have any questions or comments, our pastors would love to hear from you. You can reach them by sending an email to online@hopenow.cc. They look forward to helping you discover more about hope in Christ.